feel like I'm going to sort of move along a little bit more through some corners and stuff, I actually bring myself in just a touch so I can make sure I can get around the whole wheel if I need to.
I don't really need to adjust
me as
well,
okay? Oh, well, yeah, you'd be surprised.
Okay,
but don't worry about the middle one, because I'll be stealing that.
Okay.
Okay. Before we go, just put back and park for me. We always just do a quick pedal check as well. So if you just hit the brake nice and hard for me, give it a bit of throttle now, and if you can jump between the throttle to the brake like you're doing in a emergency stop. And again. Happy with that? Okay, in to drive then, and we all head out and around the bit harder than that, that's it. There you go. Good to go.
How long have you been doing this?
I've been doing this probably come out to 4 years actually.
Really?
Yeah. I'd say so. It'll be 4 years in Easter, I reckon.
Yeah.
Rams, when I see it. And it's been a while. And I was racing beforehand. I was racing for about 7 years as well, so single seaters.
Wow.
So, yeah.
Awesome.
It's been fun. All gets very expensive though.
Right. Sponsorships.
Quite quickly, yeah. Yeah. Well, yeah. You try and do the sponsorship route, and then you realise that you get quite a large sponsor by the end. So, but yeah. It is what it is. We're going to go all the way down to the far end. It's 30 miles an hour down here. And we're going to go to the south circuit first.
Okay.
So we'll take a left just where this car's parked up here on the left hand side, and onto the south circuit, which is just this bit here. And you can see we're going clockwise around it as well, so we'll go around here. Because we've gone out 10 minutes late, we've actually sort of dodged the crowds almost. We're sort of running behind the crowds, so we should have a bit more clearer run, to be honest. Let's queue. Okay, and just follow it round, that's it. And no need to sort of pound around here. We're not bothering to learn this track, it's just so you can get a warm up in and work and explain how you go around the corner basically. Have you ever done anything like this before? By the way,
never.
Never?
No, it's amazing to be here to do something like this.
It's good fun.
I mean, you say done racing, I mean, God, that would be awesome.
It is.
Love to be able to do it.
Yeah.
You know?
They should have a racetrack on the Isle of Wight, to be fair. That'd be fine. I think that's quite interesting.
Oh, it'll be awesome if they could do it.
Yeah. I'm trying to think of another one.
I don't know, I'm not really into motorbikes, but there's, you know, the Island TT race.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Isle of Man.
Yeah, they're trying to do an island on where I live called the Diamond Race.
Yeah. For the shape of the island, I guess.
Yeah, I reckon there's one straight part that hit 200 mile an hour down the straight. Obviously it's a public road.
Yeah. Rather than me, to be honest.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's pretty mad, yeah. He's going to pull across and we're going to go past him on the right, okay? Just so for speed reference, it's perfect. This is how you let cars pass on the big circuit. So exactly the same thing. The car in front puts the hazards on and moves over by the entrance there.
Okay.
And comes past and you'll see it on the north circuit. Anyway, are you a big motorsport fan? Do you like lucky motorsport?
Yeah. I've always been into my cars. So,
yeah.
I spend a lot of time watching YouTube.
Okay, yeah.
Racing.
Yeah.
Follow. You probably heard of a guy, Remove Before Race. Is that AMG?
No, actually I haven't. What sort of thing does he do?
He does a lot of car reviews. He's like a car journalist.
Okay.
Guy.
Yeah.
He's actually come here quite a few times.
Okay. Yeah. We do get quite a few YouTubers come down.
Do you know Schmee 150?
We do know Schmee. Yeah. Well known. Yeah.
I watch him quite a lot.
Yeah. Got a nice collection.
Archie Hamilton Racing.
Archie Hamilton. Yeah. And well, I used to was sort of racing at the same time as Archie, to be honest, as well. So.
Really?
Yeah. A lot of the guys. Known to a lot of the guys, I don't know him personally, but a lot of the guys here know him personally because they used to race with him or against him or something like that. So, go through karting with him or something like that. Right, well, you should have a sort of general idea then of how you take a corner in terms of the line of the corner, because that's the easiest thing to see from the outside of the car, isn't it?
Sure.
The sort of line you take through the corner, not necessarily what you do with the pedals or anything at certain points, but just the actual shape you're taking through the corner. So if you had to explain it to me, how would you explain how you'd go through a corner, basically? What sort of line would you be taking? If you talk out loud, basically. So talk yourself through it out loud.
Well, you've got wet line tracks and you've got dry, haven't you?
Just dry for the moment, yeah. We won't bother with wet lines.
Okay. So, if it was me, I'd be looking for the apex of the corner.
Yeah.
And then to look for the straight line to exit out.
Yeah, yeah, that's it, yeah. And where are we going to be turning in from and stuff like that? What sort of...
About halfway in.
Halfway in, okay.
Into the corner.
Yeah, I mean, we want to still get into the apex, remember? So we've got to make sure we can get into the apex. And generally, for the purposes of today, the apex is always going to be on the inside of the corner. So you always touch the white line, and that's your apex there when you touch the white line, okay? As you get more confident with going around the circuit, you'll explore more and more width of the track, and then you'll find that you can actually come in a little tighter or come out a little wider, and yada, yada, yada. But for now, just sort of pick up the apex where you touch the white line on the way through, okay? These orange cones dotted around the place, we've got them on the north circuit as well. They are your turning markers, okay?
Okay.
So they are probably the most important part of the corner after the braking. And it shows you exactly where you need to start turning the wheel. Yeah, they show you which side of the track you need to be on as well, and where to come off the brake to turn the wheel into the corner. I'll get to that a little bit later. So, for instance, here we want to be on the left hand side, waiting for an orange marker, and as soon as you get your front wheels in line with that, turn in towards the apex. Look at that, and then you come back out just like that. You barely did any turning there, did you? Because it's such a shallow corner. And with a tighter one, you notice that the turn is quite late, yeah? So that's generally what you find, is the tighter a corner is, the later the turn is going to be. Because what you want to do is, there's obviously a slower entrance into a tighter corner, yeah? Because you've got to slow the car down more to get around the corner. But, so you're going to stop it more, and then you can do more turning in one place, and you can get a straighter line for acceleration out of the corner, yeah? So, always try and be on your marks of the turning points. Some are a little bit off. Like, I find this one's a little late, but like I said, we're not learning this track. There is one on the north circuit that I'll point out, but I'll point out later. From the point at which you've turned into the corner, are you on the power straight away? Are you going to wait on the power until you straighten up? Or are you going to pick up the power about the apex? Or what are you going to do?
I'll probably put the power on about here.
Yeah. Okay, so just after you've turned in, yeah?
Yeah.
Okay.
Exit out of it so it's still gripping to pull out.
Okay, so you're not too wrong, you're not definitely not too wrong, but there is a more dynamically kind of correct way of doing it. In a four-wheel drive car, you're not going to get bitten too much by doing something like that. Because like you said, the front wheels are still dragging you out of the corner too, yeah? However, if you come up the corner, you brake for the corner, and you come off the brake at the right speed, then you can just roll the car into the apex. Yeah. If you've already got that speed, the slowest part of the corner is the apex of the corner, not the turning point, okay? So we've got to make sure the car slows down by the apex point, and then we start to speed up again, yeah? Okay. Yeah, that's fine. It's a bit chaotic out here in the manual rush, I'm afraid, so it's clearing up. So for instance, coming down to this corner here, pretending we're on a full speed lap, which we're not, we're going to be braking in a straight line before we, and then as we start to turn, we come off the brake into the apex, we just roll it,
power,
and then we power out once you can straighten that wheel up. Yeah, you watch a drag car, and it's going in a straight line, isn't it? Because they're trying to accelerate as hard as they can.
Sure.
If they're trying, the drag cars don't go around corners because they're trying to accelerate as hard as they can, and it's harder to accelerate while you're in a corner, while you're steering. Yeah. There's this whole theory about balanced throttle to balance the car through a corner and stuff like that, but that really is, they're really talking about when you initially get on the power just after the apex, yeah? Especially if it's a slightly longer period to get onto the power, your sensors just pick up the power a little bit and then start going for it, like in a corner like that, for instance, yeah? But there should be, if you've got it right, there should be no need to get on the power straight away as soon as you come off the brake. If you've got it right, we should be able to roll the car into the apex and then pick up the power from the apex to the exit. Yeah?
Yeah.
Now, once you're at the apex and you're on the power, we're starting to straighten that wheel. There's no point getting on the power unless we can straighten the wheel up. So we're getting the car straightened up so we can accelerate better. And we're using all of that space on the exit of the corner, just like you are now, to ease that sort of method. Yeah. So we make it as easy as possible for us by using more space. If we're keeping it in too tight, it can be much harder to straighten the wheel and get on the power at the same time. Yeah. You're giving yourself less space. So just to recap, braking this straight line towards your orange cone. We then come off the brake at the orange cone, roll the car into the apex, and then from the apex to the exit, we start to squeeze the power on while straightening the wheel up. Yeah?
I'm trying to concentrate on what you're saying. Yeah. It's like,
I'll keep repeating myself, don't you worry.
Yeah, no, it's
I'm not gonna.
I know you're
say
talking. You're not talking rubbish.
Yeah, I know. It's fine.
I'm trying to do what you're saying.
The way I'll just put it into Sport Plus mode. It is hard to learn out on a course like this. That's it. Just like that. Perfect. There you go. Roll it. Now we pick up the power. Let's just slow it down a bit. We're going to come off the circuit this lap round anyway. So we're going to finish off around here. And we'll go to the straight line area. We can do some acceleration braking exercises over there. But the easy way of remembering it, at least for me, this is the way I remember it, is you're not sort of thinking through it like a process, like I need to be off the brake now I can come off the brake, now I get on the power and stuff like that. You'll just think about where the weight of the car is, okay? Where do you want that weight to be, and how can you move it to the place you want it to be next, yeah? Okay. So for instance, if you're coming into the corner, those front tyres are going to be doing most of the work, so you want the weight on the front. We're going to come off the circuit here. Yeah, just indicate for me. I don't know if that doesn't happen, that's fine. And we'll take a right down the access road once you get to the road there.
How did you get into racing, Josh? What happened?
My dad raced and my granddad raced as well.
So
racing family. Yeah. Yeah. We'll come through go through the blue cones here on the left hand side. These little gap in the fence here. Cars lined up on our left.
Yeah.
We're just going to line up behind one of them, okay? Don't go for the middle lane because we've got cones halfway down it, so you can't be able to accelerate that far. Yeah, that's it. That's it, exactly. Yeah.
This one
right here. That's not a lane on the left hand side, it's one, two, and three. Okay, so we'll do some. First thing we need to see is just an emergency stop, and I'll explain that a bit more in a second when we've lined up to go. But so what I was saying about the sort of weight of the car. So if you're coming into a corner, first thing you're doing is braking, and that's putting weight to the front, yeah? Which isn't bad because the next thing you're going to do is turn, and those front wheels are going to be doing most of the work at that point to get the car into the corner. So having weight at the front from the braking isn't a negative, yeah? It's positive weight transfer. If we get on the power, you feel what happened when we just got on the power just to accelerate forwards like this. Where did the weight go?
Back,
yeah, exactly. So imagine you come up to a corner, you brake, turn in, and as soon as you turn in, you get on the power, car sits back, front tyres come off the ground, they're having less effect than they should be, yeah?
But you've done all the work to get the thing round.
You've done all the work to get the thing round, yeah? So getting on the power through the corner, if you do it too early, can actually extend that corner. You can actually be pushing the car wider out the corner, and you not oversteer, understeer actually. So the front tyres are doing too much work. They're trying to pull you through the corner and steer, and eventually the tyres just go, I can't do that, and just let go, and you start to steer wider and wider and wider. And yes, you're right, they do drag you through the corner, but there is a better way of doing it than that. Yeah. Right, so what we're going to do here, we're just going to accelerate to 70 miles an hour, and at 70 I'll say brake. I want you to hit brakes as hard as you can, like a full emergency stop all the way down to zero. So really use this as an experiment for yourself. So I'll keep an eye on the speedo for you, and I'll just say brake, and you just hit the brakes hard. Okay. When you're ready, here you go. Brake. Good start. Nice one.
I didn't know it could pulse.
No,
I've never driven it quite like that.
Right, down to the far end then, and back down the access road, and we'll line up again. Just have a few more runs of just acceleration braking runs. That's a good emergency stop there, that's fine.
Yeah,
that's exactly what we want to see.
Brilliant.
Yeah, we just want to see that from everyone basically, just to make sure that everyone can make the break. You'll be surprised.
You asked for an emergency
brake from someone, and they kind of just do, they kind of rest their foot on the thing. No, good. I'll just change the screen over here. Okay.
Was that Sport Plus then, wasn't it?
That was a Sport Plus, yeah. Yeah. We do have race mode. Let's try race mode actually. I do find race mode, the gearings, the revs stay a little too high. It kind of goes
too
down. It goes down a gear too much. Race mode's good for you for when you can really stretch the legs of the car, and you pretty much, you know, you're on a track basically.
Yeah.
You're able to go full power in a lot of places and keep those revs high, and that's absolutely fine. Whereas zipping about the country lanes and stuff, Sport Plus is perfect, because race mode, you just feel like it's too stuck in a gear basically. It just feels like it's not changing up. Let's just start to go here. So we'll do a similar sort of thing this time, but we're just gonna I want you to, it's not so much about you doing an emergency stop this time, except you can still hit the brakes hard, but I just want you to feel two things. A, what's going on when you hit the brakes hard, what feeling are you getting through the pedal, and also where is the weight going, not only when you get on the brake, but when the car stops as well. Okay, when the car sort of comes to a rest, where does the weight go? Yeah. So when you're ready, up to 70, back down to zero again, off you go. Stop, where did the weight go? It's a good question there.
Back to centre.
Back to centre, but quite aggressively, didn't it?
Threw
you back, yeah? It actually felt like it leaned back a bit first. We'll go down to the far end, back down the access road again. So, that's what you've got to be kind of careful of when you're coming into a corner, when you're braking for a corner. Yeah? So, the weight kind of being thrown back into the car. We want the weight to come back to near enough centre. Like I said, you want a little bit of weight at the front just to kind of help the front tyres turn into the corner. But you don't want all the way to the front, because that means you've not slowed it that much, you're still on the brakes, so the weight's all the way at the front. But you don't, again, like I said earlier, with getting on the power, move the weight to the back, we don't want to come on the brakes so quickly that it throws the weight back into the car. Okay? That can happen.
So they can come off the brake too early.
If you come off the brake too quickly. Yeah. You can come off the brake early, but slowly, and it will still keep the weight near the front. If you come off it too quickly, it will throw the weight back. We'll do it on this run, okay? So not necessarily come to a dead stop, but we'll get down to kind of lower speed, and then I just want you to just take your foot off the brake really quick. Yeah. So no sort of like easing off. We'll just wait for this car to go a bit. But so what you're looking for in a braking zone for a corner is we're trying to keep that weight near to the front just for the turning point. Okay. So we're going to have to brake quite hard to begin with, because you want to get the car slowed down. Makes sense. The earlier you get all that heavy braking out of the way, the more time you have to really fine tune that entry speed of the car. Yeah. So you're really trying to fine tune how you're going to enter the corner. Whether you want a bit more weight at the front, a bit less weight at the front, how fast you want to go into the corner, that's the second half of that braking zone, okay? So that way you roll off the brake. But just here, I just want you to feel what it's like if you come off the brake too quickly, okay? So we're going to do the same thing, up to 70, but let's say, I'll say brake at 70, and we generally brake just before that last blue cone, okay, on the left.
Okay.
And as we pass that blue cone, I'll say off the brake, and I just want you to take your foot completely off the brake.
No fault, just everything off.
Just take your foot off, it's fine, yeah. We got room.
Yeah, sure.
When you're ready, off you go. Brake. Half the brake. Lane. Can you feel that?
Yeah.
Actually feels like it's suddenly shifting.
Yeah, it's like it wants to keep going again.
Yeah, it's, you feel the weight kind of shift back quite quickly. Yeah. Not aggressive or violent, but it's just a bit too fast, yeah? So your job as a driver, the most important part of the corner is the braking zone, because it sets the whole car up for the corner, yeah? If your braking's rubbish, then you can basically throw the corner in the bin, because you're just basically holding on to it for the rest of the corner. You've got to get that braking right, and I'll show you that now. It's something called threshold braking, and then that kind of transfers into something called trail braking, which is when you start braking in towards the apex. But maybe not today, maybe that's another time. But it's fairly easy to pick up once you've picked up the whole threshold braking thing. So,
do you ever left foot brake and throttle at the same time?
Not in a road car, to be honest.
No,
because... Yeah, no,
if you were racing?
Yeah, when I was racing, yeah, because...
Why would you do that?
Because it allows you to sort of, you don't have to, there's no gap between getting on the power and getting on the brake. And
so that's more quick response.
Yeah, in fact, it's a bit more kind of like direct. You can kind of, imagine you're trying to steer with your feet if you didn't have a steering wheel, you were usually the steering was on your feet. You find it easier with using both feet when you go left, right, than jumping between the pedals the whole time, yeah? It's a little bit like that, but also the cockpit in a single seater is tiny, so the clutch pedals generally lead over to the left there, and then you just jump off it and use your left foot. And also, you don't need the clutch to change gear in most race cars, so you just flat the pedal or something like that. Or in my F3 car, we had a engine cut, so you load up the gear lever and cut the engine just briefly, it'll pop into gear, which ruined your hand, but so you had massive bruising along there.
Really?
Yeah, in a road car, I generally don't do it because the pedal's just too soft. I mean, my right foot's used to it, but my left foot just isn't used to that slack. If you hit a brake pedal in a race car, it is like that. It's like it's more of a pressure servo than actual lever. It's like you just put pressure into it, you push back into the seat quite hard. So anyway, that's another thing. But so what we're going to do here is a bit of threshold braking. Now, when you felt the ABS going off, do you know what the ABS is actually doing at that point in the car?
Well, it's an anti-skid, isn't it? So it's like incredibly fast it's doing that, basically.
Yeah, essentially, yeah. And you heard
the sensors that are operating the brakes to...
That's it.
It's doing that, and you
everyone, everyone does that, they just kind of look at me and go, is it crab or something?
Yeah.
No, but you're right, yeah, they're taking them on and off and on and off and on and off, yeah? It's basically cadence braking for you, isn't it? If you ever driven an old car without ABS, it doesn't have that effect. And when you lock up, you've got to come off the brake and get back on again, and come off again, and get back on just to get the wheel to turn again. That's exactly what ABS is trying to do. It's taking the brake off to try and get the wheel to turn, and then putting the brake back on at the pressure that you're asking for it, and it locks up again and takes the brakes back off again. Now, with that in mind, do you think ABS is the quickest way to stop? Taking the brakes off, and then actually when you put the brakes back on, it's braking so hard that it locks the tyre up and starts to slide, and then take the brake back off again, and then repeat.
I think I reckon it is doing the right thing.
Okay, so what if I told you could brake much quicker without using the ABS? It'd slow the car down much faster. Yeah,
really?
I mean, watch every single F1 race. They're not locking up and keep braking into every single corner, because it's just not the fastest way to get to the corner. The fastest way is to try and get the most braking you can without actually slipping the tyre. Just like if you come through a corner, the fastest way through the corner is not sliding. The fastest way through the corner is to roll the thing through on the limit of grip, but not overstepping that limit of grip. Drive the car within its own capabilities, basically. So what we're going to do this time is a bit of threshold braking, okay? And that threshold is the threshold at which the ABS comes in. So you want to brake as close to that limit as possible. So you want to get as much braking on as you can. If you feel a bit of ABS, don't panic and jump off the brake. Just ease off the pressure just a touch.
Okay.
And you should find that it's a much faster deceleration. If you can get as close as you can to the ABS, it should really put the brakes on. Yeah. When you're ready, now it's chopped it down. When you're ready, up to 70, and at 70 I'll say brake, and I want you to hit the brake as hard as you can without touching the ABS. Okay.
Tried to get it on where
it's
kind
of. It's your first time doing it, but what was really useful in that is in the middle you had a bit of ABS.
Yeah,
crunch noise, like the hit the bumper there. And it felt, it would go around. Did it feel like to you that it suddenly shot on a little bit?
Yeah,
exactly. So that's a perfect demonstration that braking with the ABS is not necessarily the fastest way to get the car stopped. It's actually braking as close as you can to it without touching it, because you're braking, you're using the maximum you can from the car, and any further than that is just detrimental after that, for sure.
Take a bit of practice.
It does take a bit of practice, and that's where I'll go around again and then give you a bit more, a few more runs of it,
You call that trail braking, you said?
Threshold braking.
Threshold.
And then trail braking is when you use that same technique, but you're actually starting to brake while turning in towards the apex of the corner. But like I said, that's a tricky one, and to be honest, there's not many corners out on the circuit that you'll really get a good trail brake on. And it's a tricky technique to pick up. You've just got to get on top of the threshold brake first, and then, to be honest, it kind of naturally progresses into trail braking. You'll find that you'll start to, as you start to turn into the corner, just like you can't accelerate hard while you're turning, you can't brake hard while you're turning, because it's the same effect, the tyres just can't that much. You can brake as you're turning, but as you start to increase the steering lock, you start to reduce the brake pressure. So you end up just doing it, keeping the weight much no closer to the front. You get a lot more turning, but you've got to be careful. You brake too hard and it suddenly slips and goes a little bit too wide. That's it. We'll do the same thing again. Up to 70, back down to zero with a threshold brake. Okay, when you're ready. Stopping because the tyre is not being overloaded, so at the very least, if you needed to, if you're threshold braking like that, you could actually steer out of the way of something without the tyre slipping.
It kind of feels like you've got like a, how can I describe it, it's like almost like a bubble. So when you
a bubble,
when you're like on the pedal, rather than it's sort of, you feel like it really like ripping, doing what it does, it's like you can feel like, it's almost like there's a bubble under your foot, but you know you're not right on the limit of foot.
Exactly. So imagine you're trying to squeeze that, let's say it's a balloon.
Yeah.
Trying to squeeze that balloon as much as you can before it pops. That's a really good analogy, actually. I'm going to use that. So it's a really good one. I think in very visual terms like that as well. The analogy I always use for the way you come off the brake, which I'm going to use now, is, so when we get on the brake, it's like you like you said, it's got that balloon under the pedal, and you're trying to squeeze it as much as you can without popping it.
Yeah.
As you come off the brake, the reason I said it was a little quick at the end there is because we jumped off the brake and you feel the weight kind of shift back. We're trying to move that weight from the front to the centre as slowly as we can to keep the car as stable as we can while still getting the car stopped too. So the one I use for this is, imagine the brake pedal, instead of it being a brake pedal, it's actually a ball that you're holding underwater with your foot. Now if you take your foot off that too quickly, it's going to spring up to the surface, probably smack you in the face. If you bring it up nice and gentle, then the ball rests to the surface. That's exactly the sort of feeling that I, that's the analogy I use, and it kind of works for me. I don't know if it works for you or not. It kind of makes sense. So you're just trying to keep resistance on the pedal, but still allowing it to rise up. Yeah, so that's kind of the sense of it, essentially. We're going to have to wait for this car to go. We'll do a couple more, and then we'll do a race start.
Okay.
So you can have a look at that. And then we'll go to the, I think we'll go to wet circle. No, we'll go to track first. We'll go to track first. Yeah, just a little scouting run. Nothing too serious.
How do you compare where these are steel brakes with everything you've just explained to me?
Yeah.
Say ceramics, is it the same?
Same thing. Yeah.
Exactly the same.
It's not even necessarily about the material of the brake or anything like that, or how certain different brakes work.
To how you drive it, you'll drive it the still same
it's
technique.
Just, it's the dynamics and the physics involved in the car. Okay. And at the end of the day, you're not the brake is not touching the road, the tyre is touching the road, and that's what you're trying to affect through the braking, if that makes sense.
Sure.
There's not, other than turning the steering wheel, there's not actually much you can do to affect the tyre on the road directly, if that makes sense. You know, when you turn the wheel, you twist the tyre into the road. When you accelerate, the suspension compresses and that pushes the tyre into the road, so there's something between you and the tyre there. And when you brake, the brakes grab, the suspension compresses and it pushes the tyre into the road, which is another thing, so it's two things. So, there's not really any sort of braking style that's different between steel, ceramic, carbon ceramics, whatever. Yeah, it's just the same sort of deal. So, we'll do the same thing again, but this time what I want you to do is do exactly the same thing you're doing at the start, because it's great, and then just towards the end, just try and ease off the brake even slower. Just really try and keep that resistance at the front, okay?
Got you.
When you're ready, off you go. Just forward of centre. Doesn't have to be all the way at the front, doesn't have to be bang in the centre. Just forward of centre is fine. And then rolls the car into the corner. You've got loads of grip at the front, because that you've got a little bit more pinch at the front. We'll do it one more time around, and then we'll go for a race start. And I'll get you away from the straight line bit, because we've been there quite a while actually. But it's interesting stuff, and it's really important to understand.
Yeah.
Because, like I said, it sets the whole thing up.
It's what wins a race, I suppose, as well.
Yeah, I mean, you don't know what races you'll be entering in the other way, but, just on the right, yeah, we'll go for the right-hand side one. It's a shorter queue.
Two?
Number three, yeah. Yeah. Three. Yeah, exactly. It's what how many F1 races have you watched where a position has been lost because someone's locked up into a corner and gone wide? That's exactly what loses you a race, is by braking a bit too hard, and admittedly they're trail braking, so it's a bit harder for them, but they lock up, they go wide because they brake a bit too hard, and the person who's braked properly behind them takes the corner, whizzes it straight through, no problem at all. It's just they've forced them into a mistake there. But we're not being forced into errors or anything because they're not getting pressured. Just about feeling the weight in the car. Comes back to what I was saying earlier, the easiest way to remember it is just feel the weight of the car and how it's moving around. Don't worry about too much about sort of the process of it or the techniques involved. If it feels right, it is right. And there's quite a close relationship between your brake pedal and how you move the brake pedal and how the weight of the car shifts. Yeah. Yeah, I've pointed.
So what am I doing now? Okay.
We're just going to do one more run of that, of a nice trail break. Yeah, exactly. Okay. That's a nice threshold break. We're going to wait for them to go first, though. And then we'll come around and do a race start. It's going to go eventually. He's old, bless him, he's getting there.
How many instructors like yourself do you have?
As in what, ex-racing drivers, or just in terms of working?
Both.
Here? Both. Okay. So I think today is quite it's a medium busy day. So we've probably got like 10 of us here, but you can have, on a very busy day, you can have upwards of like 20, 30 of us. Yeah. When you're ready. Thing, then kind of you
as soon as I felt that, I let it off.
Yeah, a bit more. Exactly. You came off a little quick when you first got the ABS, because I think you sort of took you by surprise.
Yeah.
But then after that, you recovered it very well. So, for instance, in a sort of track scenario, if you did that into a corner, you'd still make the corner because you caught it early enough, you caught the sort of mistake early enough with you, and you managed to still balance the weight by the time you got to that turning point. Yep. But for instance, if you had pressed the brake a bit too hard later on, or held on for too long and got the ABS, then you'd have even less time to sort it out.
Correct.
Exactly. Yeah. You can imagine the sort of the rush you'd be in to try and get the car sorted. Right, we'll go through one more time and we'll just do a race start. Number one, yes. Let's go for number one. Okay, so you haven't done a race start in your car yet?
No, I'm not sure.
So to do a race start, left foot on the brake.
Yeah.
Left foot on the brake.
Sorry.
That's it. There you go.
What's that there?
Dylan, see you, Mark, here.
Sorry.
Mark, my guess is your passenger's father. He just wanted to check that his son's doing okay. Yeah, he's absolutely delighted. I can see you on the streets. Yes, no problems.
Okay, then. So it's on a passenger
ride.
Right. So to do a race start, just pump the brake briefly because it's on the whole brake there. So just give it a pump. There we go. So keep a nice firm brake on like that, just like you are now. We then want to.
Not a passenger ride, sorry. Just got to keep my eyes at the back of my head at the moment.
If you tickle the brake, tickle the throttle, sorry, or build them. Not yet, sorry. if you tickle it or build it up too slowly, the car just doesn't realise what you're trying to do. It will just hold it against the brake, basically. What you want to do is you want to, not just yet, floor the throttle. Like bring it right to the full power, and then the car works out what you're trying to do. The screen will be flashing red and it will say race start available. At that point, let the revs build up to about 4,500, they'll go burp, 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 off the limiter, and then you just drop the brake, keep your foot flat on the power, and off it will go.
Do you have to have traction off? Or
no, it actually applies full handling mode for just the launch, yeah.
That's all that.
Yeah, and then it turns it back on the
right.
So, yeah, so head back and floor the power. No, there we go. Off the brake. Brake.
So I didn't brake this.
No, it's fine. That's
fine. Surprise.
Yeah, no one does the proper brake off in the race start. Do you want to do one more of that?
Yeah.
Just so
yeah.
You can get it into your head a bit more, the process of doing it.
I thought you had to have traction off, but it's...
No, so what happens is that...
Left foot on the brake, build the revs up, foot off the brake.
Yeah, easy. It used to be a whole process of like pulling paddles and switches and everything like that, but now it's just on the brake, floor it going. Because once it realises that you're doing race start, it will put it into something called sport handling mode, just for the launch, so you get that little bit of slip, just so the launch is a bit more, the traction control won't get in your way as much, because... As soon as it does, it just kills the power basically, doesn't it? But sport handling mode, which I'll show you later on the circle, is a reduced effect of traction control on the ESP. Yep, so it will step back a bit and let you drive the car a bit more. So same thing again. Hold brakes on, just give it a pump. There you go. When you're ready.
Finding that balance when the ABS is going to kick in without you going too far, isn't it?
Yeah, is that the key?
Trying to find that level,
exactly.
How much pressure.
Exactly. Okay, we'll go to the circuit.
Cool.
And have a little look around there. This is where all those cars are filing on there, just by this bus shelter on the right. Going up here on the right hand side. It is a two-way entrance exit. Okay, and we enter on the left-hand side, so try not to block the exit too much. We're kind of cutting across early, just make sure you kind of square it off a bit more when you're turning into a junction on the road. Because people will be whizzing off here sometimes, so a little bit further on. That's it. Okay, just so you sort of get out of the way a bit more. Hold it there. Okay, this is the North Circuit. It's clockwise only, as you can tell. Keep it between the white lines. There is no overtaking, but there is a passing spot, and it's right in front of us. You know what? When I said earlier about the car on the South Circuit moving over for us, yeah, when we pass them on the right, same thing happens here. Car in front will put the hazard lights on and move over to the left-hand lane in this little lane here. If it's us, we make sure we move forward at the same time, so don't sort of pull over and stop. Pull over and move forward at a slow, steady pace, and they'll pass on the right hand side. But there's one coming up now, you can watch exactly what happens. So the one in front is going to move over to the left hand lane with the hazard lights on, just like that. Car behind, waits for a space, goes straight past them, and then you can see how the car merges at the far end. That's the important thing. We'll wait for all this gaggle of cars to come around. It's a little bit busy on the track, to be honest. We all sort of seem to follow each other around every area. Once the blue cars come round, we can go for it. We'll wait for the black car to get going though first. When you're ready. Okay, so, just take this first 10 minutes just to learn the place, really. And don't worry about sort of specifically what you need to be doing at certain points, really where you need to be, because you don't even know which direction the corner's going, yeah. So just learn the place, get it into your head, and sort of just figure out.
It's white there, isn't it? You come round white.
Yeah, so it's a big fast corner, this one, yeah. So we've got our cone system out here as well. Got a few extra ones though. So these ones are your braking markers, so you're gonna be starting to brake from here. Bear in mind it's wet as well, so you probably will be. Turning point there. Apex marker here, so that's your apex, yeah. So when you see an orange cone, when you see a cone on the inside, regardless of colour, it's your apex marker. So that's your first apex. It's a bit of a weird corner, this one.
Tiny hand turns.
Yeah, it just keeps turning, yeah. It just keeps going. Yeah. Another one. So if you see two, it's got a double apex. You stay on the inside for just that bit longer. Yeah. Apex here. That's it.
Go wide here?
Not too wide, just come up to the dotted line, just in case there's people parked on the outside lane. You just want to stay in your lane, basically. Double apex here, so you pick up the first one, and then the second one. That's it, just like that. This cone on the outside here is just keeping people across. It's not actually there for anything. That's it. So, I'll give you a little proper guided tour around now we've done a lap. Sort of explain where you need to be certain places. So down here on the left hand side, you can see it's covered in rubber on the right hand side, so you start on the left, braking nice and firm from the little braking point, rolling off that brake pedal. I'm going to take the mirror once again. Out to the left hand side, nice and early, and it's straight back in.
Can we have a sideline,
keep it tucked in, that's it. You can actually keep it a little tighter than that. Straight into the first apex here, keep it tucked into the left hand side on the exit, so you have to wait for a long time on the power. I'm going to just let a car pass. So it's going to move across the left hand side, over to the left of the dotted line. Keep moving forwards up to this orange and white barrier at the far end there. That's it. Hang on. Sorry, that's my bad. We've got plenty more cars to come through.
Okay, hang on. No, sorry. My bad. It's coming off. I'll wait for the A45 to come through.
Okay, when you're ready, off you go. Should have plenty of space behind us now. Okay, so plug the blue cones until the second one and then let the car run all the way out. Use all this space up here. It allows you to straighten the wheel up and get the power. Brake it nice and firm for your orange cone. Tuck it in late. Straight line out to the left hand side, so straight out of the wheel and accelerating all the way through the corner. That's it. Out to the left, so use that space on the left hand side. Don't push yourself too hard to begin with, just sort of figure out the sort of line, get the flow of it down, you know. Out that's it, there you go. Thank you. Wait for the second blue cone. And then we go and grab this first blue cone here and keep it tucked into the left hand side on the exit here. So it's right on the left hand side, left, more left than that. And off the power, in towards your first apex, back on the power again, nice and early, up to the bottom line. That's it. Braking, towards your first corner, straight across into turn two. Hug the first part, the second blue cone, let the car run out towards the building. Yeah. That's it. Brake nice and firm. Off the brake, roll it in, just like that. Try not to pick up the power too early, make sure you're waiting until you straighten up the wheel. Yeah. Once we start to roll a little bit more speed into the corner from off the brakes, but that just comes with time and practice, basically. Just a bit more confidence in the car, basically. Yeah. So off the power, don't brake, roll it in, and then we pick up the power. Yeah, nice and smooth. Braking in towards turn one, straight across into turn two, off the power briefly, and then we pick up the power again towards the exit. That's it. Well, it's coming too early there. We're just sneaking in before the orange cone. Yeah? Back to the left hand side. And on the power all the way through. Keep building up. This fast corner is more of a continuation of the hairpin you've just been through. Yeah? It's more treated more like just sort of an exit, but it's curved. So you kind of just keep building up the power all the way through from the hairpin to the straight. Keep it tucked in a little bit more, that's it. Touch, once you straighten up, power roll it through, wait for it, off the power, now pick up the power. Did you notice how as you came off the power, it tucked in?
Yeah.
The weight got to the front a bit more, and put those front tires, give those front tires a bit more to grab onto, yeah? Straight across into turn two, hug the first part, and then we pick up the power towards the exit. As we straighten the wheel, that's it, braking. So you just came in a little too early there again. That orange cone is your turning point, believe it or not. It's very late, but it is your turning point. On the power. Take those small, slower corners like the hairpins and stuff,
wow.
Just see how much speed you can roll through it, and then you get a really good sense of how much grip this car's got. This corner's a little bit slippery though, so I'll just be careful about this. Just the tarmac changes and it's a bit greasy. Out to the left hand side. Just move some weight to the front. then we just, like there, we get on the power way too early, and now it's finally pushing us out. This last corner then becomes a big old chicane, yeah? We don't want it, we don't want those last two corners, like a left, right.
Okay.
We want it like a little
straight line.
Just a little thread through, yeah. So we try and keep it tight in on the left hand there, before it, the left hand there. Angle, we can just flick it through with no brake, yeah, and just come off the power and just throw it. We're just was getting a little bit kind of frantic through those hairpins. That's all. No, it's not. It's good. It's okay.
It's all good. Join us.
Yeah, it's good fun. Whereabouts are you looking when you're going around the circuit?
Here, I'm looking as far as I can over there.
As far as you can over there, okay. So, through the hairpins, where would you say you're looking?
Not enough.
At the apex, yeah?
Not enough.
Look through. I'm basically, when I go through there, I'm trying to find my next apex, the next corner, yeah? So, going into here, go to the first one, look for your next apex, yeah? Then look for your next apex, the second blue cone, yeah? And we're looking for through the side window for our next turning point over here. Left. Straight up. Then look through to the orange markers over there. That's it. Like that. That was probably your best run yet.
Right.
Yeah?
Yeah, got it.
So you've just got to be mindful. It happens so much. Faster stuff, people start to pick their vision up because they're travelling faster. Looking further ahead. As soon as they start to slow down, they start to look at the road right in front of them. Yeah? Pick that vision up. Look what's coming up, look where you need to be, and you'll be surprised how easy it is to find your way to the next point. That's it. That's it. Off the brake. Beautiful stuff. Now you're starting to trail brake. Yeah? Yeah, you're starting to turn while coming off the brake, which is excellent. Just mind that you, just for the braking zone at the end of the straight here, you start to just, as you start to brake, you start to come across the track. It's not necessarily turning, it's actually you're just making your way to the middle of the circuit and then you turn in. And then you've arrived at the corner with half the space that you need. Yeah. So just make sure you've got enough space and give yourself enough space by staying in the straight line. Out to the right, open the steering up. Lovely stuff. Out to the left. Whoa, hang on. There we go. So we had to delay our proper acceleration there. Brake. Use up the brake. That's it. Hey, nice. Good stuff. Roll it in. Wait for it. Now we pick up just a tickle of power, just a little bit. So that's a touch too much, that's almost half power. Left. Do one more lap, I think, and then we'll have a break. Yeah. On the back. Like I said, we don't need to brake there anymore. We're actually trying to carry the speed through that corner, straight across. That's the right. Open steering. That's it. Brake straight across the track. There you go. Roll it in. Open steering up and on the power. That's it. That's better. Much more like it. There you go. Yourself into the corner before you've actually got to the turning point. The track at that point is still going straight. Yeah. We'll come up for a second to that round then. We'll take a left. If you indicate for me as well, just so people to come online if there are people coming online. Take a right, that's it.
Wow. Joshua, you're brilliant. Girls. Top man, yeah.
That's alright, no worries. I mean, pick up stuff very quickly, and you just seem to click one lap with that braking. It just suddenly made a lot of sense to you. You just went roll off the brake into the corner. Absolutely the way you meant to do it. Perfect. Then take a right here. Basically, if you come off the brake and you don't even notice you've come off the brake, because there's literally a hold it there just for a second. If you've come off the brake and you don't even notice that you've come off the brake because there's no weight transfer, there's no kind of like sudden kind of shift in weight.
It's trying to think, well, not think.
Yeah.
That's the thing, isn't it? You're trying to think what you need to do next, but not overthink it.
Yeah, exactly. And that just comes from, I mean, that was, 10 minutes out there, a little bit more than that, but 10 minutes out there.
Josh,
will
you listen to this clockwise?
Are you okay
with that, over?
Yeah, go for it. It's about just the more laps you do, the more you, it's like learning a musical instrument or something. First of all, you have to have the sheet music in front of you. It's because you need to know what's happening next and you have to be reading it and you probably stop a few times to sort of go, oh yeah, I remember that bit, oh yeah, I remember that bit. And eventually you build up that muscle memory eventually you're just playing without even thinking about it. You can just do it while talking to someone. Yeah. And that's the point at which everything starts to flow on track, because you don't even need to think the corners through anymore, because you know where you need to be just naturally. You know where to get the power, you know where to stop the brake and everything like that. You don't have to think about that stuff. It's just... And then that, from that point on, you've got more brain space to start thinking about the balance of the car and the overall sort of handling issues that you might have and stuff like that. So you can start to pick up on those instead of thinking, oh, where do I need to be coming out of this corner, or where do I need to start braking from this corner? So, yeah. But yeah, like I said, like, I bet you anything, your brain will be digesting all that information right now, and we'll go back there in 10 minutes and it'll just be even faster, you'll pick it up even more. It's just through those hairpins, it's so easy to do, like just look down at the row and look down at the apex directly, like 20 feet in front of you. I mean, that's no real use, is it? Because it'd be pretty impressive if you managed to miss that apex from 20 feet out. So it's just, you might as well look at the next thing up the road. And it's amazing how much your hands follow where your eyes are looking. Yeah, it's not just about sort of receiving that information early. It's about you're looking that direction. That goes through your brain, and the brain goes, okay, we want to go over there. It starts putting your hands in that direction. And the moment we did those hairpins and we were looking out the side window for our next corner, it's amazing how you just sort of went, whoop, just round we go, and then flicked it through, and that's your best time you did it. Yeah. Right. Listen to Wet Circle. It is two at a time, and we're going to go the same direction as travel, as the other car. And we keep a nice distance between each other. There's no point being stuck up behind them, because no one can do anything. And then we'll do. There's no overtaking whatsoever as well. So if a car spins or stops, everything else stops as well. We just wait for them to get going again. And we'll just do some stuff with traction control, ESP, all that stuff. So, automatic and sport handling and drift mode.
I was told once, I don't know if this is true, if you go into a skid, you do opposite lock or something, is it?
Yeah, so it's such a...
Or is that not? I don't know.
No, you're right. It is called opposite lock. But it's such a vague term. Or people say steer into the slide. It's like, to the average person, where is the slide? You know, if you go into a slide, you just steer into the slide. It's like, for a lot of people, that means that way, when if you're sliding that way, then you turn away from the slide. But for some people, that makes sense. That's in the slide, you know.
So same principle, something like this?
The way I describe it is you steer the direction you're going. Yeah? Because that always makes sense. If you're sliding that way out of the corner, steer that way. Yeah? Because what happens is, as the car rotates, it then the tyres are then sliding across the road at that point. So they're creating more friction. Yeah, that means they're slowing down. They're going to be sliding and making friction. They're slowing down. If you then align the front tyres in the direction you're going, then these front tyres have less friction on them. The rear tyres have more friction on them. So eventually the car goes. The front half of the car has an easier job of rolling. It goes, whoop, like that, straight up. So the general idea is that with the opposite lock thing is that you're trying to get the front wheels steering in the direction you're going, so they have an easier job of rolling, and then they'll straighten up, so the back of the car can kind of fall in behind it like that. We'll get onto that a bit. I was just having a little go in the drift on drifting it earlier, and it is a bit nuanced to try and get this car to go sideways, I'm not gonna lie. You kind of have to move the weight over quite slowly and then give it a load of power to sort of bring it round like that. But that just shows you how much grip this thing has. I mean, if you have to do that on that surface to get it to go sideways, it just shows you how gripped up it is. Like you said, on the surface is great. Alright, so on we go. Staying between the white lines. Down below 20 miles an hour is absolutely fine. In fact, even slower than that is even better. 20 is sort of your limit at the moment. Just because you've got this guy out ahead. When you're ready, bring the speed right down, in fact. So let's come right down below 10. And then when you're ready, just absolutely floor it and see what happens. So, what did you feel then in the car?
Just sort of vibrating, it just seemed like it feels no traction.
No traction, yeah, so it's a very slippery surface, so no traction. But then you're full power, and you weren't getting anywhere near the throttle response that you were expecting, basically, were you? So, yeah. You've got less power, the traction control stepped in and gone, we're not giving you that much power, we'll give you this much
power. 30% power.
Exactly, it's taking a lot of power away from you. The vibration you felt was a little bit of tyre scrub across the side, because of turning sideways, sliding sideways by that point. But it's also a little bit ESP as well. The ESP is the thing that's breaking individual wheels around the car, just comes to a stop. It's breaking individual wheels around the car to pull the car into a straight line or stop it skidding or whatever. I don't fully know what the process is, but for instance, if you went into a left-hand slide oversteer, it would, in my brain, you'd probably brake the front left and it'll kind of pivot the car around that tyre then. But it's all kind of
Yeah,
magic.
Yeah, sure.
The car just kind of waves the magic wand and you kind of
tries to correct itself.
Exactly, yeah.
Yeah.
So that's where we're all the systems on. If we press this little button down here, just once, you get something called sport handling mode, which I alluded to earlier with the race start. Yeah.
Yeah.
It's a reduced ESP and traction control setting. Okay. Maybe wondering why the hell you want that. It just allows you to. If you're confident in the car and it's a nice day and you know the roads, or if you're on a track and you want to let the car go a little bit more, then it's a nice thing to have, because they've still got that safety net, but they've just lowered the safety net right down here.
So rather than giving you 30%, it'll give safety.
Yeah, instead of falling off the tightrope and you being caught straight away by the net, you fall off the tightrope, have a little scare, and then go, oh my God. So it gives you a little bit more movement, okay? So let's just slow it right down again, sorry. Down to the sort of same speed we started at, the wheel spin at. And give it some power now. There you go. So, you can see the difference, yeah?
Yeah.
Really lets the car go a lot further.
I was on ice and just sliding there.
Yeah, exactly. And that's what you find with a four-wheel drive car. When you spin the wheels, all four wheels spin.
Right.
So then the car just kind of floats out of the corner. So it just exits stage. Goes, I'm off, see you later. There is a way of handling that, and we can have a look at that in a bit. Hold this button down for 5 seconds, I'll press it because then we have to turns everything off. Okay?
So you've got no traction.
No traction control.
You're literally purely driving skill.
Purely driving the car, nothing in the way of you in the car. To turn everything back on, you press it once. Same thing with sport handling mode, you just press it once. Yeah.
Everything off, hold it down 5 seconds.
Yeah, that's it. So sport handling mode is a toggle. You just go on, off, on, off, on, off. Yeah, just press it once and it will turn it on and off. To turn everything off, you hold the button down and turn it all back on again, you press it once. That's fine. Okay. So give it some throttle now, 2 hours. No ESP as well, to keep you coming around the corner. And again. Floor up, hang on.
That's pulled a lot.
Yeah. So
I was trying to keep it going.
Yeah, that's fine. So what you're getting there, if you just keep rolling around about 15, that's fine. What you're getting there is something called understeer, okay? And it's going to be very common in your car to get understeer, just because of the way it's all set up. It's four-wheel drive, which lends itself to more understeer. You've got more power to the front, which lends itself to more understeer as well. And front-wheel drive cars, if you've ever driven many front-wheel drive cars, they basically just understeer. You don't really go oversteer unless you throw it into a corner. It's also a kind of boxy shape, which is understeer. If you get a longer shape, you've got more lever, and the car will kick the back end around more. The C43 that we've got here is four-wheel drive, but you've got more power. Slightly more power to the rear, but it's also a saloon shape, so you find the car kicks the back end around more. Yeah, exactly. Whereas your little car here, nice short lever, is going to sort of understeer more than going here. So let's learn to deal with a bit of understeer, and it's very important to know how to do that, because we picked up understeer on the circuit sometimes when we get on the power too much in the mid corner, it starts to push out. Yeah. So we'll do the same thing here. I want you to pick the speed up until we start to understeer naturally. So just gently build the speed up. It'll be about 20, 24 miles an hour, I reckon. Yeah. So after all of that,
oh, I don't know what.
After all of that, that was actually oversteer. Just did big slide of oversteer. Did you stay on the power?
No, it's let off.
It was let off.
Is that right?
No. Well,
I didn't know what to do.
In a four-wheel drive car, when it starts to oversteer, you actually want to just keep a little bit of power on.
Right.
Weirdly, because what happens is the front tires start to slow down, and that engine braking can kind of bring the front round the back of you. Basically, they'll start to slow down quicker because they've got engine braking on them. So what you want to do, if you've ever been on an outboard, you've probably been on the boat with an outboard motor or something like that. Yeah. It doesn't turn unless you give it power. Yeah. Those front tyres are still powered, so we need to give it a little bit of power just to get the front to turn. So yeah, exactly. So do the same thing again.
24-ish.
About 24-ish, yeah.
And what you want, just kind of try and keep it there.
So yeah. I mean, it'd be quite tricky at that sort of speed. But. Unwind that stop. Unwind that lock. There we go. So you felt a little bit then, yeah? Just before you hit the tarmac, it actually started to straighten up. Yeah, see what I mean?
Interesting.
Okay, so we'll jump off the circle here this time round, and we'll go to the west straight, just because there's a bit of a queue. Sure. So we'll just keep on
walking. Go round up there?
Yeah, no. We'll just go up to the access road, so around the left-hand side of this car. And then left down the access roads, we'll go to the wet straight, which is just on our right here. So we need to go through those blue cones that we went through earlier to get to the straight line area. But then we take a right once we're in there. And we'll do a bit of drift mode stuff on the wet straight, just so you can kind of feel it on the straight line first. What I was going to say was, so you kind of felt how you do oversteer first, yeah? Weirdly. In this car, I was not expecting that, to be honest. But just park it within the blueprints here. That's fine. But to get the car to just gonna let the golf course. Just don't argue, just go.
Very nice.
What you felt then when it was after the slide happened and we whacked a load of steering lock in, yeah, that's a big old bag of understeer. Like you said, you're on the lock stops, you basically couldn't turn anymore. Now, when you're understeering, what do you think you should do? Remember what the whole...
Understeer is when you're sliding out, so you need to...
Oversteer is when you're sliding out, when the back of the car slides.
You need to give it more lock.
Remember what the whole job of being the driver of the car is? You're trying to keep the car gripped and within the capabilities of the car. Now, if the tyres have slipped at the front and they have reduced turning effect and they can't quite get around the car anymore, can't quite get around the corner anymore, sorry. How would adding even more steering lock help with that?
Exactly.
Not quite, no. Just off the power. Off the power, straighten that wheel up. Get those tyres to connect to the road again. Yeah. If the tyres are slipping at this angle, why would they then turn more or grip more if they turn at this angle or this angle? Yeah. Which is what we're doing when we wind that steering lock in. We need to get those tyres. Say we're the tyres are slipped at this angle, but we're actually relatively we're turning at kind of this angle. Yeah. So we need to get those front tyres straightened up to the point where they grip back up again, at kind of relative angle of the corner. So it's kind of hard to explain. Basically, understeer is when you're not turning enough at the front, and we need to get those tyres back to within their limits. Basically, just like with the braking, if you brake too hard, you get the ABS to come in. We need to straighten up the wheel so the front tyres get back into their limit. But anyway, we'll do a little bit of that in a second on the wet circle again, but I just want you to feel the drift mode on the wet straight first. So we'll go down to the blue cones down there. And just stop between the blue cones down here. So we're all on all the wet stuff. Okay, to get into drift mode, we need to go into race mode. See on race mode there, yeah?
Drift mode,
manual. So we need to be in manual gears. And we need to be all assistance off. Okay? And then you pull both paddles in. Hold them in. Then let go. Let you pull that paddle. There you go, drift mode active. Okay, so now we've got that drift mode thing going on. So we've got a little bit more power centre to the rear, but it's also got that outside left rear tyre. The outside rear tyre is going to be giving more power to the outside. So give it some power now, and just try and just have a mess around on the wet straight down to the far end there. Just give it some power and go for it, just see what it feels like.
Back end just spins up
and then second gear. Up.
Drift,
I'll let you do it. I'll let you do it. So it's in your mind then.
Straight on.
Straight onto the circle, but we'll come on. We'll stop. No, we're going to stop anyway. So we're going to stop to do drift mode. So if we just hold it here. Okay. So I'll put it back to sport plus mode so we can do the whole thing. So race mode. Manual. Press that once. All assistance off. Hold the button down. It. Pull both paddles in, let go, pull the up paddle, drift mode active. Okay? So when you're ready, pick the speed up to about 10 miles an hour, and then once we're in 10, we're gonna stick into second gear, okay? That's it, okay. Good stuff. Now when you get on the power hard, not only don't you have that assistance, so it's gonna keep the car around, but it's also gonna send more power to the outside rear, which would be the left in this case. So it's going to try and unstick that rear a little bit more, yeah? Now, the difference with this, the way you get the car to move in the A45S, is if you're in a C63 or an E63 with drift mode on, you'd just be driving around like this, and you'd just give it a burst of power, and the back of the car would come loose, and it would do that, yeah? The A45 still has power being sent to the front, so it still behaves just like that. Still behaves like a four-wheel drive car, yeah? So we need to kind of help it unstick a little bit more, yeah? So we need to do that thing. We start on the inside white line, then we go straight line out to the outside white line, and just before we get there, we turn. So carry on round. So instead of doing a kind of circle shape, we're kind of doing a kind of hexagon shape, going out to in, yeah, in straight lines, okay? So we come into the white line here, nice and tight, and then go straight line about now. So we're heading to the outside now, yeah? About 10 miles an hour. Wait. No, keep going straight. Okay, back into the white line then. So we need to keep going straight until you basically get there and do a hard turn right and then give us some power. So straight line, straight. No, straight. Turn, power. A bit harder than that, okay?
Harder throttle?
Much harder than throttle. Okay. Slow it down now. We want to arrive at the outside white line about 10 miles an hour. So in nice and tight, straight line to the outside. So make sure we're going straight.
It.
And then right, power. Off power. Not bad. Just got on the power a little too early, that's all.
Yeah.
Into the white line on the tight. Straight line. Wait for it. Turn. Power. Too light on the power.
Yeah.
Give it some.
Yeah.
Really got to give it some.
Okay.
Got a lot of grip this car, even in the road. I was trying drift mode on the track earlier, and I was trying to be an absolute animal with it. You know, everything I've been saying to you today, I was just trying to ignore. and it's fine, that's fine. And then right, power. That's it, off the power. Power. Keep going. Off the power. Right. Off the power. Nicely done, good stuff. Open steering up.
It's interesting.
Do you feel that point which you just lift up? That's what I'm talking about, okay? So up until then we were sliding the tyres sideways across the road, and then we went bang and just locked them back into place, yeah?
Yeah.
Open stairs. Open right. So remember those front tyres are still being powered off there. Those front wheels are still being powered, yeah? So if we're straightening up too much, we can steer against the slide, yeah? We can steer away from the slide. And actually put that too early on that. Yeah. We'll do one more lap though.
Okay.
Yeah, we're good. Just keep going for it. Too early on the power again. We're going to make sure we get that weight shifted across and then get on the power. That thing that's helping to unstick it, yeah? At the moment, if you get on the power too hard and as you're turning, it just unsticks the front instead. Yeah, wait for it. Wait. Power.
Yeah.
Turn right? No, not enough. We'll go straight line out to
here.
That here, that's it. Right. Bam. That's it. Just keep catching that tarmac, that's all. We'll jump off here though.
Sorry.
That's alright. But can you feel that? As soon as you unlock that steering lock, as soon as you take that steering lock out when you're understeering, can feel the point of grips back up again. Yeah?
Yeah.
Straight on. As you get more familiar with that feeling, it'll become much more less this. It'll become much more, you'll become much more sort of fine-tuned to it. Yeah, you'll feel it a lot more subtly. You'll feel when the tyres just start to slip and just take a touch out. Just like when you get on the brakes too hard, you get a bit of ABS, it just ease off a touch. Yeah? Just like that. Yeah? But there we were finding extreme examples of it. We'll go to the track now. Find extreme examples of where we're whacking loads of steering lock in and then going whack like that and taking it all back out again. On you go. Yeah. Last 10 minutes on the circuit. All the systems back on. By the way, to take it out of drift mode.
Am I out of drift now?
Yeah, we're out of drift mode. We're back in Sport Plus with all the systems on. To take it out of drift mode, all you do is just change one of the parameters that you need to put it back, put it into drift mode in the first place, yeah? So you can either change it out of race mode into something else, you can put it back into automatic instead of manual, and you can turn the assistance back on. Just one of those things will take it out of drift mode. So let's warm back up for this lap. Use that space, remember, that's quite tight there. Out of these ones, we want to keep it tight because we don't have time to get across the circuit if we need to. Tight to the left there. We're going to roll it through the corner as well. On the power. That's it, good stuff. A little bit too much power mid corner. Over the power. That's it, over the steering. Be a little bit more sort of gentle with that steering on the straight line out to the left hand side. That's it. Brake pass firm. There's the sensor. He's going to let us buy this lap round. So if we just stay, if we hold position behind him here.
Go ahead for Harris and Keys.
Just keep behind him. A bit faster. Roll off the pulled it through. Wait on the pump. No.
Oh.
You thought I've gone on board in here.
All right, look ahead.
Look ahead. Through the corner. The important thing is, if you feel like you've got it wrong, just don't panic about it. Just try and manage it a bit more. I've got a brake pedal too. You'll know if you're coming in too hot if you feel me on the brake too.
Okay.
Yeah. But I did feel like we were. So. When you're ready, off you go. Roll it straight across on the power. Roll it through. Back on the power again. That's towards the opposite. Nicely done. Out to the left hand side. Open steering. Wait. Now he's turning on the path. Go for it. Second run, but there were some good bits in it. I just think you spooked yourself a little bit and you tried to go through it.
We'll
take it right, yeah? That's good though.
Yeah, good fun. Thank you so much.
That's alright, no worries. It's,
really enjoyed it.
It's nice being able to just throw your car around a bit and see what it actually can do. Yeah,
it's so nice.
Wow. Don't get a chance on the road, really. So.
Awesome.
Good stuff. Let's go. You're going to hang around here and have a look around first?
Yeah,
go home and then
I'd like to.
Yeah, good stuff.
That's brilliant, Josh. Brilliant. Learning a lot, you're a good teacher.
Thanks. So I tend to sort of take a right here. I can be a bit of an information overload sometimes.
I'd rather have more information than I know.
As I say, I like if you've thrown off your mistakes.
You know what I mean? And I've got it on USB, so exactly. I can refresh my theory. You know what I mean?
You can watch it back and realise I was talking absolute rubbish the whole time. So talking absolute gibberish. It wasn't actually making any sense. Straight across. And we'll park it up in one of these bays up on the hard standing up here. So if you just swing it around back at number 5 here, there's a space on the other side of it. That space right there, that's perfect. Thanks very much.
Last one. That was brilliant fun, thank you.
Park it down the other off.
There you go. Wow.
Thanks very much.
No worries.
Thank you.
What's it, I mean?